On July 18, 2018, Allegro, the largest e-commerce platform in Poland, known for feats such as creating a viral 3-minute-long Christmas advertisement, not being racist, and the Allegro Zone, decided to launch a very special limited-time sale. They were going to sell 100 Honor 7C phones, whose regular price was about 200 euros at the time, for a mere 1 Polish unit of currency. This offer was scheduled to start at noon, and marketing material for the event had already been published. At 11:15, 45 minutes prior to the deal going live, the engineers knew that website traffic was going to spike, so they preemptively scaled out the listing service to prepare for the onslaught. All of their microservices were configured to automatically scale based on response times and other performance metrics, so it probably wasn't going to be that bad. As the minutes passed, traffic crept up steadily, and by 11:50, website traffic was already 50% higher than the same time the previous day. Getting closer to noon, the latency of major services had risen to impacting levels. The load was rising too sharply for the autoscaler to catch up, so the engineers intervened and manually scaled out. However, they soon ran into an error, stating that all the capacity in the cluster had been used. This was unexpected, as based on their napkin math, there should have been tons of capacity available. While the engineers pondered this, their front-end service was also getting overloaded, leading to instances failing to report their health status and subsequently being terminated. But does this mean the entire front-end got terminated? If you recall, these instances were all part of an auto-scaling group which automatically scales based on certain metrics. There are three key numbers you need to worry about when taking care of your first ASG, the most important being the desired size, which is the number of instances which the group will attempt to scale to. This is the only dynamic number here. When traffic goes up, the desired size should go up, and when traffic goes down, the desired size should. Second is the maximum size. You could set this to infinity for infinite scalability, but there are realistically going to be other bottlenecks in your system. For example, if your load balancer only supports 100 targets, there's no point in scaling your service past 100 and wasting money. Third is the minimum size. This prevents the service from scaling down excessively during traffic dips, so there is always some level of minimum availability. In the Allegro scenario, having this minimum size prevented all the instances from getting killed at the same time from simultaneously failing health checks. But ironically, this was slightly helpful since this functioned as a throttling mechanism of sorts and staved off some pressure from the back end. How's the back end doing, by the way? On the bright side, automatic rate limiters began kicking in, redirecting excessive or suspicious traffic to a blank rate limiting page. However, the site's rate limiting coverage was incomplete, and the blank page had the classic Twitter retry behavior of generating extra retry requests for no reason. Many customers also manually refreshed pages when they didn't load, further worsening the retry storm. Also, despite the high CPU and RAM usage, there was another processing bottleneck here, the server's file descriptor limit. What are file descriptors? Well, to understand that, we first need to ask, what is a file? So a file is just a sequential stream of data, which may be opened and traversed, read from, written to, and closed. How does a Linux process access a file? Well, you make the system call open, and it returns a handler or file descriptor, which the process uses to access the file. But what exactly is this file descriptor? Secondary storage, such as your hard drives, SSDs, floppy disks, flash drives, magnetic tape, and punch cards, are physical storage, and must integrate transparently with the file system software for users to interact with. Now, the Unix kernel represents any of these storage options as a sequence of logical block numbers from 1 to n, where each block is a fixed size, usually 8 kilobytes. So when a file is saved to disk, it occupies one or more of these blocks. So perhaps the file descriptor is simply a list of all of the blocks on disk? Well, that would mean the application layer is responsible for writing content to arbitrary blocks, in which case if you accidentally pass in the wrong block number, it's just asking for corruption. Furthermore, there are concurrency issues here where the block numbers stored in one process could become outdated when another process modifies the file. Perhaps the kernel maintains a data structure that contains information about the file's blocks, plus a bunch of other useful metadata, and the file descriptor is a pointer to this data structure. This way, we can pass the pointer into the write call, and the view of the block numbers will always be up to date. Well, this data structure does exist, and it's called an index node or inode, but this is still missing some key features. A simple pointer, which could be defined as a number that indexes into the inode table, provides no way to store open file metadata. Files in Linux can be opened in different ways. We can see a flags parameter here, the most obvious being the access mode, which is required. Each open file handler also needs to keep track of its current position in the file. All of this metadata is actually stored in another data structure, which represents an open file. Therefore, when open is called, the file descriptor return does indeed function as a pointer, represented by a non-negative integer. This number is the index of a newly created open file table entry, containing information about how the process opened the file, which maps to the inode table entry containing information about the file itself. So Linux has always traditionally limited the default number of file descriptors you can create to 1024, meaning you can only open 1024 files. Like many family traditions, the original intention behind the limit is shrouded in mystery, yet cherished and followed with reverence. However, after a bit of digging, you will find that back in the day, no file, the keyword for this file descriptor limit, affected the size of various data elements regardless of whether or not the file descriptors are actually being used. Thus, it would be sensible to set it to a reasonable value. Though this is no longer the case today, the limit still remains the same. So how does this limit bottleneck the API servers? Well, serving requests require opening TCP connections, which meet the definition of a file, that is a sequential stream of bytes, and requires creating a file descriptor. The more concurrent traffic there is, the more open TCP connections, and thus more file descriptors there will be. As a result, some services hit the Linux file descriptor limit before their true processing limit. Okay, now back to the main issue at hand. The engineers found the root cause of the insufficient capacity. Some other random services had reserved far more resources than they realistically needed, so their cloud was technically out of compute capacity, as it had all been reserved. Reserved capacity here refers to virtual CPUs and memory that is allocated to a particular service. Although Allegro uses a proprietary private cloud environment that they run on premises, reserving capacity is nothing new. For example, in AWS, you can reserve 100 P316 EC2 instances for a year for $13 million, after which this 100-strong pool is assigned to you, and whenever you need to launch an instance, you grab one from this reserved pool. Otherwise, if you try to launch 100 unreserved or on-demand instances, there's no guarantee that they will all be available at the same time, especially if it's of rare type. Anyways, Allegro shut down the unnecessary services to free up the capacity and started manually scaling as usual, and everything was fixed by 12:20, about 25 minutes after the initial impact. This was just due to a bad configuration which went unnoticed until now. But this left a bad taste among the customers. Some accused the promotion of being rigged, and many were disappointed having added the phone to the basket but failed to finalize the transaction. But just like the phone, which was on sale, Allegro came out of the setback with honor. The 46 customers who were found to be in the top 100 but could not complete the transaction due to the website crashing were given vouchers to purchase the smartphone for the sale price, eligible for a week. And thus concludes another one of Allegro's grand feats. We'll meet again in the next episode of the Allegro Zone.